welcome to the Audio Renaissance presentation of Managing in the Next Society, written by Peter F. Drucker, adapted for audio by Richard O'Connor, produced by Tony Huds, and read by Arthur Morey. I did once believe in a new economy. The year was 1929, and I was a trainee in the European headquarters of a major Wall Street firm. My boss, the firm's European economist, was convinced that the Wall Street boom would go on forever. He wrote a brilliant book to prove conclusively that buying American common stock was the one absolutely foolproof way to get rich quick. Not yet 20, I was recruited to be the book's proofreader and its index maker. The book was published 2 days before the New York stock market crash and disappeared without a trace. And a few days later, so did my job. And so, when 70 years later, in the mid-1990s, there was all that talk of the new economy and of a perpetual stock market boom, I had been there before. At the time when everyone began to talk of the new economy, I became aware that society was changing, and more so as the decade progressed. It was changing fundamentally, and not only in the developed countries, but in the emerging ones, perhaps even more. The information revolution was only one factor, and perhaps not even the most potent one. Demographics were at least as important, especially the steadily falling birth rates in the developed and emerging countries, with a resulting fast shrinkage in the number and proportion of younger people and in the rate of family formation. And while the information revolution was but the culmination of a trend that had been running for more than a century, the shrinkage of the young population was a total reversal and unprecedented. But there is also another total reversal, the steady decline of manufacturing as a provider of wealth and jobs to the point where, economically, manufacturing is becoming marginal in developed countries, but, in a seeming paradox, politically all the more powerful. There is, again unprecedented, the transformation of the workforce and its splintering. These changes, together with the social impacts of the information revolution, are the main themes of this audio program. And these changes have already happened. Irreversibly, the next society is already here. Major social changes that are creating the next society will dominate the executive's task in the next 10 or 15 years, maybe even longer. They will be the major threats and the major opportunities for every organization, large or small, business or nonprofit, American, North and South, European, Asian, Australian. Indeed, it is the thesis underlying every section of this program that the social changes may be more important for the success or failure of an organization and its executives than economic events. The truly revolutionary impact of the information revolution is just beginning to be felt. But it is not information that fuels this impact. It is something that practically no one foresaw or indeed even talked about 10 or 15 years ago. E-commerce. That is, the explosive emergence of the Internet as a major, perhaps eventually the major, worldwide distribution channel for goods, for services, and for managerial and professional jobs. This is profoundly changing economies, markets, and industry structures, products and services and their flow, consumer segmentation, consumer values and consumer behavior, jobs and labor markets. But the impact may be even greater on societies and politics and above all on the way we see the world and ourselves in it. At the same time, new and unexpected industries will no doubt emerge, and fast. One is already here, biotechnology, and another, fish farming. Within the next 50 years, fish farming may change us from hunters and gatherers on the seas into marine pastoralists. It is likely that other new technologies will appear suddenly, leading to major new industries. What they may be is impossible even to guess at, but it is highly probable, indeed nearly certain, that they will emerge, and fairly soon. And it is nearly certain that few of them will come out of computer and information technology. The information revolution is now at the point at which the industrial revolution was in the early 1820s, about 40 years after James Watt's improved steam engine was first applied in 1785 to the spinning of cotton. And the steam engine was to the first industrial revolution what the computer has been to the information revolution, its trigger, but above all, its symbol. The Industrial Revolution moved at least as fast as the Information Revolution and had probably an equal impact, if not a greater one. In short order, it mechanized the great majority of manufacturing processes, beginning with textiles. Moore's law asserts that the price of the Information Revolution's basic element, the microchip, drops by 50% every 18 months. The same was true of the products whose manufacture was mechanized by the first Industrial Revolution. The price of cotton textiles fell by 90% in the 50 years spanning the start of the 18th century. The production of cotton textiles increased at least 150-fold in Britain alone in the same period. The Industrial Revolution mechanized the production of practically all other major goods, such as paper, glass, leather, and bricks. These 40 or 50 years gave rise to the factory and the working class. But the social consequences went far beyond factory and working class. The explosive growth of the steam engine-based textile industry revived slavery. Considered to be practically dead by the founders of the American Republic, slavery roared back to life as the cotton gin created a huge demand for low-cost labor and made breeding slaves America's most profitable industry for some decades. The Industrial Revolution also had a great impact on the family. The factory took worker and work out of the home and moved them into the workplace, leaving family members behind. Indeed, the crisis of the family did not begin after the Second World War. It began with the Industrial Revolution. But despite all these effects, the Industrial Revolution in its first half century only mechanized the production of goods that had been in existence all along. It tremendously increased output and tremendously decreased cost. It created both consumers and consumer products, but the products themselves had been around all along. There was only one important exception, one new product in those first 50 years, the steamboat. Then, in 1829, came the railroad, a product truly without precedent, and it forever changed economy, society, and politics. The railroad was the truly revolutionary element of the Industrial Revolution. Not only did it create a new economic dimension, but also it rapidly changed what I would call the mental geography. For the first time in history, human beings had true mobility. For the first time, the horizons of ordinary people expanded. Contemporaries immediately realized that a fundamental change in mentality had occurred. Like the Industrial Revolution two centuries ago, the Information Revolution has only transformed processes that were here all along. But the Information Revolution has routinized traditional processes in an untold number of areas. The software for tuning a piano converts a process that traditionally took 3 hours into one that takes 20 minutes. There is software for payrolls, for inventory control, for delivery schedules, and for all the other routine processes of a business. There is software to help people do their tax returns and software that teaches hospital residents how to take out a gallbladder. The processes have not been changed at all. They have been routinized step by step with a tremendous saving in time and often in cost. The psychological impact of the Information Revolution, like that of the Industrial Revolution, has been enormous. It has perhaps been greatest on the way in which young children learn. Children now rapidly develop computer skills, soon surpassing their elders. Computers are their toys and their learning tools. But as to the way we work, the Information Revolution has so far simply routinized what was done all along. E-commerce is to the Information Revolution what the railroad was to the Industrial Revolution. A totally new, totally unprecedented, totally unexpected development. And like the railroad 170 years ago, e-commerce is creating a new and distinct boom, rapidly changing the economy, society, and politics. One example. A mid-sized company in America's industrial Midwest used to have some 60% of the market in inexpensive dinnerware for fast food eateries, school and office cafeterias, and hospitals within a 100-mile radius of its factory. China is heavy and breaks easily, so cheap china is traditionally sold within a small area. Almost overnight, this company lost more than half of its market. One of its customers, a hospital cafeteria where someone went surfing on the internet, discovered a European manufacturer that offered china of apparently better quality at a lower price and shipped cheaply by air. Within a few months, the main customers in the area shifted to the European supplier. In the new mental geography created by the railroad, humanity mastered distance. In the mental geography of e-commerce, distance has been eliminated. There is only one economy and only one market. One consequence of this is that every business must become globally competitive, even if it manufactures or sells only within a local or regional market. The competition is not local anymore. In fact, it knows no boundaries. Every company has to become transnational in the way it is run. Yet the traditional multinational may well become obsolete. It manufactures and distributes in a number of distinct geographies in which it is a local company. But in e-commerce, there are neither local companies nor distinct geographies. Where to manufacture, where to sell, and how to sell will remain important business decisions. But in another 20 years, they may no longer determine what a company does, how it does it, and where it does it. Anyone who 20 years ago predicted that books would be sold on the internet but delivered in their heavy printed form would have been laughed off the podium. Yet Amazon.com and BarnesandNoble.com are in exactly that business, and they are in it worldwide. The fastest growing e-commerce in the United States is in jobs for professionals and managers. Almost half of the world's largest companies now recruit through websites, and some 2.5 million managerial and professional people have their resumes on the internet and solicit job offers over it. The result is a completely new labor market. This illustrates another important effect of e-commerce. New distribution channels change who the customers are. They change not only how customers buy, but also what they buy. They change consumer behavior, savings patterns, industry structure, in short, the entire economy. What the new industries and institutions will be, no one can say yet. The one thing that is highly probable is that the next 20 years will see the emergence of a number of new industries. At the same time, it is nearly certain that few of them will come out of information technology, the computer, data processing, or the internet. There is also a service waiting to be born. For example, insurance against the risks of foreign exchange exposure. Now that every business is part of the global economy, such insurance is badly needed. The next 2 or 3 decades are likely to see even greater technological change than has occurred in the decades since the emergence of the computer, and also even greater change in industry structures, in the economic landscape, and probably in the social landscape as well. The new industries that emerged after the railroad were possible only because of the mindset that the Industrial Revolution had created and the skills it had developed. This was a mindset that accepted and welcomed invention and innovation. It also created the social values that made possible the new industries. Above all, it created the technologist. The technologist, still self-taught, had become the American folk hero and was both socially accepted and financially rewarded. Samuel Morse, the inventor of the telegraph, may have been the first example. Thomas Edison became the most prominent. In Europe, the businessman long remained a social inferior, but the university-trained engineer had, by 1830 or 1840, become a respected professional. The key to maintaining leadership in the economy and the technology that are about to emerge is likely to be the social position of knowledge professionals and social acceptance of their values. Today, however, we are trying to straddle the fence, to maintain the traditional mindset in which capital is the key resource and the financier is the boss, while bribing knowledge workers to be content to remain employees by giving them bonuses and stock options. But this can work only as long as the emerging industries enjoy a stock market boom. The next major industries are likely to behave far more like traditional industries, that is, to grow slowly, painfully, laboriously. Bribing the knowledge workers on whom these industries depend will therefore simply not work. The key knowledge workers in these businesses will surely continue to expect to share financially in the fruits of their labor. But the financial fruits are likely to take much longer to ripen, if they ripen at all. And then, probably within 10 years or so, running a business with short-term shareholder value as its goal and justification will have become counterproductive. Increasingly, performance in these new knowledge-based industries will come to depend on running the institution so as to attract, hold, and motivate knowledge workers. When this can no longer be done by satisfying knowledge workers' greed, as we are now trying to do, it will have to be done by satisfying their values and by giving them social recognition and social power. It will have to be done by turning them from subordinates into fellow executives and from employees, however well paid, into partners. Most CEOs still believe that it's the chief information officer's job to identify the information the CEO requires. This is, of course, a fallacy. The information officer is a tool maker. The CEO is the tool user. Let me illustrate. Recently, I got around to repairing the overstuffed sofa in our guest room, which I should have repaired 3 years ago. At the hardware store, I asked the owner which upholstery hammer would be best for the task. I didn't ask him whether I should repair the sofa. That decision was my job. I merely asked him for the right tool, and he gave it to me. CEOs must accept that if the computer is a tool, it is the tool user's job to decide how to use it. They must learn to assume information responsibility, which means asking, what information do I need to do my job? From whom? In what form? When? As well as, what information do I owe? To whom? In what form? When? Unfortunately, most people still expect the chief information officer or some other technologist to answer those questions. This won't do. When we learn to use information as a tool, we are learning what to use it for, what we need, in what form, when, from whom, and so on. The moment you examine these questions, you realize that the information you need, the really important information, you cannot truly get from your information system. Your information system gives you inside information, but there are no results inside.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.